You're now sitting, you're going to be raised up again by our speaker. He tends to do that, you know, he raises up people. Now, Reverend John had a problem, because it is February, deciding whether he was going to talk about Valentine's Day and love, or about reggae, because it is reggae month, and it is Black History Month as well. So there he is. What am I going to talk about and write about? But of course, you know, of course, the one that he chose ultimately. Of course he's going to talk about love. Let's hear what Reverend John has to say.
Thank you, Reverend Michael. Thank you, Reverend Michael. Yes, I'm going to talk about love. So welcome to my heart this morning, this wonderful, beautiful audience here in gorgeous Jamaica, land we love. And welcome to those who join us in consciousness and watch us on the World Wide Web. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Can we just say a big I love you? I love you. I've been thinking about love, and then I was really trying to decide what I should be talking about today. And then a part of my life came to see me on Friday to begin planning her wedding, and I thought, yes, this has to be love. So love it's going to be. You know, if you want to know anything about anything, ask a child. And I got some quotations from kids on their opinions on love. The first question put to the kids was, how do you decide whom to marry? Alan, age 10, says, you got to find somebody who likes the same stuff. Like if you like sports, she should like it that you like sports and keep the chips and dip coming. Kristen, also aged 10, very wisely said, quote, no person really decides before they grow up who they are going to marry. God decides way before, and you get to find out later who you're stuck with. And then when asked how a stranger can tell if two people are married, 8-year-old Derek said, you may have to guess based on whether they seem to be yelling at the same kids. And what do most people do on a date? 8-year-old Lynette said, dates are for having fun, and people should use them to get to know each other. Even boys have something to say if you listen long enough. Isn't she a treasure? Martin, age 10, said of dating, on the first date, they tell each other lies, and that usually gets them interested enough to go for a second date. And when is it okay to kiss someone? When they're rich, says Paul, age 7. I totally agree. Anita, age 9, feels it's better for girls to be single, but not for boys, since boys need someone to clean up after them. Bless her heart. How would you make a marriage work? Ricky asked. Ricky, age 10, said, and I quote, and he could be one day a marriage counselor, I promise you. Ricky says, tell your wife that she looks pretty and you love her, even if she looks like a dump truck. Well, you know, when I was about 10, I wondered about this business myself. I was about the same age as Ricky. And I was astonished to learn that my parents courted each other for 7 years before getting married. So I asked my dad how he knew that he was in love. I was in love with a little girl called Vanessa who lived next door on Sanders Crescent. Her father was the chief brewer for Red Stripe Beer. I wonder if that's where I got my taste. Anyway, I was totally besotted with Vanessa, so I said to Daddy, how do you know? How do you know when you're in love? And he said, son, love is a choice. You can only love one day at a time, and with each new day, you restart the process. Jeez, you mean you have to do it over every day for 50 years? I didn't feel fully satisfied, so I headed for the kitchen to ask my mom the same question. Mom, how do you know when you are in love? She said, you're in love with Vanessa. Ever the practical one. in the partnership. And then she said something that really puzzled me. She said, you know you're in love when you wake up beside the person for the umpteenth time, and for the umpteenth time you thank God that this person is in your life. So I wanted to say, and you woke up beside daddy for 7 years before you decided to marry him. But I decided to quit while I was ahead. They were liberal, but not to that extent. So she said, it's a choice, and it's when you know that you have made the right choice. And so I've entitled my encouragement this morning, Choosing Love. I think we could talk about that. Can you choose to love? Mother Teresa said, and I quote, there is more hunger for love and appreciation in this world than for bread, unquote. And Dr. Ernest Holmes, who in 1927 founded this great teaching known as the science of mind, said, and I quote, love is more than a sentiment. It is a need, a hunger, a thirst, which is perfectly natural. Anyone who thinks he can live and be happy without it does not really know what he's talking about, psychologically, emotionally, physiologically, or spiritually. Love is the beginning and the end, the one sentiment in nature that will not be denied. End of that Ernest Holmes quote. So friends, love is the strongest attracting power in creation. It has been called the universal glue that binds all of life together in one great miraculous union, making all of us part of one God. Just think about that. You're a part of God's love. You're a part of the heart of God. You live in the heart of God, and God lives in your heart. God is love, and if we will let it, this love can put us in touch with our own divinity, giving new meaning to being in love. For this overused phrase would mean that we are plumbing the inner depths of divine love. When we love from this inner place, we create harmony in our relationships and begin to see the divinity and perfection in others. So I want you to think about it this morning, that being in love would mean that we are in touch with our own godness. When you are in love and love is in you, you begin to understand that lasting relationships result from being the right person, from being the right person, not finding the right person. You get the difference? So stop looking out there and look in here. And so I want you this morning to choose the greatest love of all, and that is to love yourself. Wow! Love yourself. And so your first assignment this morning is to go home today and write yourself a Valentine's card. Make a Valentine's card for yourself, telling yourself why you love yourself, why you wake up with yourself every morning and say, thank God I'm with the person I really love. And when you can do that, you begin to be able to express that lovingness, that goodness, that godness, that totality of your being to anybody else whom you meet. Let us affirm together, I revere the divinity in others. Together, I revere the divinity in others. I behold everyone with eyes of love. I behold everyone with eyes of love. And I glory in their perfection. And I glory in their perfection. To your neighbor, say, I behold you with eyes of love, and I glory in your perfection. Namaste. I behold you with eyes of love, and I glory in your perfection. Namaste. I behold you with eyes of love, and I glory in your perfection. Namaste. Miss said your neighbor, not the whole church. When you accept the higher image, my friends, of who you are, you stop relating to others in terms of their physical appearance or their behavior, and you are able to express respect, kindness, love, and compassion for everyone. So as you and the little boy come to wipe your windshield on the way home from church today, just say silently in your heart, I behold you with eyes of love. And I glory in your perfection. And I stuck my windshield. But basic principle, my friends, is that there is only oneness. There is only one of us. Like it or not, you better believe we are all one with everything and everyone we encounter. So instead of trying to change or fix someone whom we perceive to be the source of our problems, who gets to us and who irks us, we need to remind ourselves who that person really is, a unique individualized expression of the one God that created all things out of itself. So instead of focusing then on their outer appearances and behavior, their idiosyncrasies, their clothes or behavioral quirks, we can instead say, you know, here is a spirit. Here is a beloved child of God that is expressing the infinite, expressing the life force of God and the beauty of God in their own unique way and through their own unique personality in the things they do and how they do them. I see God in this person's way of being. I behold this person, what? With eyes of love, and I glory in their perfection. You know, one of the biggest lessons I have learned on my spiritual journey is how to keep my heart open and to remain loving even when others are upset or angry with me, or when they withdraw their friendships, sometimes without even explanation. Some even walk away from the church without explanation. And it's really a challenge to look within yourself and say, how did this happen? And what was my part in this? And that's when I resort to that wonderful prayer that I taught you at the New Year's workshop. Ho, open, open, no. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I love you. Thank you. But I keep my heart open so that no matter what, I remain John the Beloved. Not somebody else's idea of what John the Beloved should be, but who I really am, a beloved expression of God. And I really think that that name really suits me, because I feel that love for everybody I meet and everybody I encounter. So here's a little hint, because it's never about you. It's never about the other person. It's always about you. Trust me. Reverend Dami used to say that life is a mirror, and if you look in the mirror and your hair don't look good, don't comb the mirror. So when other people irk you or hurt you, it's really a wake-up call for you to look within yourself and to see what part of you needs to be healed. So I'm going to give you a little hint. Pay special attention when a particular behavior is mirrored back to you from three or more different people. If three or more people are irking you the same way, another them are you. Look within yourself. Because you know what, friends? To an angry person, everyone else appears hostile. To a suspicious person, everyone they meet appears to be what? Suspect. To a loving, tender-hearted person, everyone seems worthy of love, and every encounter is an opportunity to offer love and to share from heart to heart the beauty of our own divinity. So if you find more than three people get into you on the same wavelength, you need to raise your vibrational level to love, which is the highest octave in the universe. When you begin to practice love as a daily spiritual practice, it will heal all kinds of things in your life. People will sit beside you at the cinema or in church or wherever, on a bus, in a taxi, and they will be healed and not even know that it is the vibration of love that you are emanating, which is doing its perfect work of harmonizing and balancing, and it just creates complete homeostasis. Wherever it is you go, you will be a vector of love, and love will be healing everyone and everything that you touch, that you encounter, and that you lay your attention on. Now, I don't want you to go away and think that I'm saying that if you are loving and accepting, you'll never experience difficulties in relationships. People will still get angry at us with people who... And people won't deal with us very nicely sometimes. That happens. We may have to look harder to see the divine in them. There may also be relationships that are abusive or unhealthy, and in those instances, you may need to remove yourself from the situation and even seek professional help. Seek out a practitioner or a counselor. But I'm saying, even then, you can still love the abusive person without loving, tolerating or condoning the behavior. And you can still look past that behavior to see the God presence within them. And perhaps if you can do this with enough faith, you may even begin to change who they are and how they behave. Because when you look at things, the way you look at things, it changes them totally. When you look at things one way, they tend to become that way. That's how the law works. You actually alter reality by your looking and your perception. So demonstrating love, kindness, compassion, and gentleness in your relationships means having a loving connection, not just to another person, but to yourself as well, which means setting your intention to see God in all relationships, all the time. I love what my mother said. You have to wake up every day and say, yeah, I choose this again. It's a daily reconfirmation and reaffirmation, a rekindling of the love that you chose. Because, you know, when you're falling, I love the expression, it's like a roller coaster, you know, whoosh, you don't even know what's happening to you when you're so-called falling in love. But after a while, it steadies off, doesn't it? And then you have to begin to really work on maintaining the love vibration which attracted you in the first place. And that's when you have to start looking past the sneakers in the living room and the unwashed dishes and the unmade bed and the wet towel thrown down in the bathroom to see, I behold you with eyes of love and I glory in your perfection. Beg you tidy up the room for me before you leave for office. There's a touching story about a teacher who decided to do an experiment with his kids on recognition and appreciation. And he gave each of the students a blue ribbon with this written on it: who I am makes a difference. Who I am makes a difference. It was written in gold on blue ribbons. And he gave each student one and then gave them three additional ribbons and told them to pass them on to someone who they wanted to recognize in this way. One student gave his to a junior executive who had been helping him with his studies. And as he gave his mentor, he said, wear this for me and pass on the appreciation to someone else. It's a class project. The junior executive gave the ribbon to his boss, who was known to be a grouch, saying, I want to recognize your creative genius. Who you are makes a difference. The junior executive asked the surprised boss to pass on this appreciation as part of this whole project of passing on appreciation and love. Well, the boss went home and, calling his teenage son, told him how an employee had recognized him for his creativity and had asked him to pass on the recognition. And he said, you know, son, as I was driving home, I thought who you are really does make a difference in my life. I know I don't give you much of my time, and I'm always yelling at you about your grades, but I want you to know that next to your mother, you are the most important person in my life, and I love you, son. The amazed boy, tears streaming down his face, revealed to his dad that he had made up his mind to commit suicide that very night after his parents had retired. There is a suicide note upstairs on my dresser. I didn't feel I mattered to you at all. Wow. See the power of love? In a book by Gerald Jampolsky titled Out of the Darkness into the Light, he writes, and I quote, we withhold love from ourselves by denying it. We think that there is something out there in the external world that we need. We begin to get upset when we don't get it. We try to control people. We try to manipulate people and live a life where there is a lot of attack, a lot of saying, I'm right and you're wrong. People don't realize that the battle we see out there in the external world is really just an extension of the battle that goes on in our own minds. End of that quote. Jampolsky makes the point that problems in relationships usually escalate when the spiritual element is absent, because when we feel separate from our spiritual being, we begin to feel fearful that we are going to be attacked. And so here's a commercial. Young people who are planning to get married and older people who have been married for a long time and have to make the decision every day that this was the right choice, come to church together. There is something about the collective consciousness of love and togetherness generated in spiritual community, which will be the cement and the cohesive factor in your relationship and in your ongoing building of a life together. Come to church together. You know, sometimes we withhold it because we use it like a bargaining tool. Sometimes we withhold it because we think if I give it, everybody's going to get a piece of it. And I don't want those people who may not check for to get piece of my precious love. It's precious, you know, it's fine for the people we love, but those that have transgressed or hurt us, or those who we don't check for, we don't think they should have any. Well, it's like a musician. It would be like Maestro Dexter saying, I'm not going to play at church this morning because somebody's in the audience who I'm not pleased with. And the music has got sweet them too. Or an artist who wouldn't paint a picture just because somebody else who they don't like may see it. Can you imagine a world of constructed like that? Does that make sense? Not at all. So the truth is, you are perpetually radiating the emotional energy, the love field energy, which enriches your world. Hate-filled or hurt-filled or jealousy-filled or nenge-nenge-filled energy depletes, impoverishes, and eventually destroys you. No, do it. Practice radiating love. Mother Teresa articulated her conscious choice to express her energy positively when she said, and I quote, "Why should I expend energy in anger that I can expend in love?" In Matthew 5, verses 25 and 26, the beautiful Jesus advises, and I quote, "Agree with thine adversary quickly whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt in no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing." Unquote. As usual, the master teacher is talking about the law of mind. And the two key words in this are agree. To agree means to settle with or dispose of an adversary. And the adversary are those adverse thoughts or reactions to people and life's situations. So settle your upset with life's adverse situations quickly before they take root and become a part of your consciousness and a part of your experience. In painting the powerful picture for his listeners of the adversary delivering them to the judge and the officer in prison, Jesus is illustrating how, when a negative thought comes to mind, if you don't settle with it and dispose of it immediately, it can lead you to disharmony and dis-ease in many, many forms. In his book, The Power Within You, early New Thought writer Eric Butterworth writes, and I quote, "In every experience we face, there is always a time when ultimate problems exist merely as seed possibilities. In all bitter feuds between people, in all wars between nations, in all emotional problems of individuals, there was always a time when misunderstanding could have been turned to understanding, when envy could have turned to respect, when resistance could have been resolved by love." So in giving this powerful advice, Jesus is urging us, don't procrastinate, don't put it off. Whenever you begin to experience adverse feelings and think negative thoughts about someone, deal with these feelings immediately before that little spark of negativity escalates into a raging fire and you become imprisoned in an impossibly difficult situation that is just consuming you. If someone criticizes you, agree quickly. That is, deal immediately with the tendency to be defensive and resent the critic. All you need to say is, thank you very much for sharing. I'll give that some thought. That was very useful. Thank you. Rather than, me can't do nothing good for you, eh? If you do not dispose of the adversary of your negative reaction at the very onset, the poison in you can build until it robs you of your peace of mind. You can carry others on your back. in hurt and anger for years, not knowing that it is completely in your mind because you, your thought, is your very life. And I never forget, you know, I was doing a workshop many years ago. It was in a hotel, and one of the participants at the that worked at the hotel, I was talking about the same thing, forgiveness and love and carrying the burden of unforgiveness for a long time. And she said, you can talk, you see, my brother do me something. And she then said, I can't get over it till today. The way she spoke, it was with so much passion. I thought it happened last week or maybe last month. It had happened 20 years before. I said, no, you need to go to him and heal it. She said, no, we count him dead. I said, he has gone to his maker, and you are still carrying this resentment and this hurt. She said, not only carry it, I have the letter and write my mother. And she took out of her handbag a little yellowed, creased, impossible to read piece of paper that he had written. Some foolishness that she and her boy went to Grass Peace Hotel and was fooling around when they were teenagers. And it evidently wasn't true. And she carried that resentment. She admitted it had colored her own relationship with her own children and with everybody else in her life. I said, are you willing to get rid of it now? And she said, after a long wait, yes. And at the time, there were ashtrays still in hotels, and I took an ashtray off the back table, and I said, drop it in there, and I gave her a match and said, light it. And friends, I'm here to tell you that as the little piece of paper went up in smoke, her face physically changed. The lines on her face began to smooth out, and she looked 20 years younger. Can't tell you. And she said next day when she went home, her daughter said, what happened to you? And they never, what happened to you, Mama? The change was so pronounced and so profound. We need to let go the hurt because it consumes us. Agree quickly. Get your mind and heart and soul into a state of love and understanding and non-resistance. Make a choice today to love unconditionally. You have to start. My dad said it when I was 10. You have to start over every day. There's a lovely old hymn. New every morning is the love my wakings and arisings prove. It's true. You have to renew your love every day. Renew your love for your partner. Renew your love for your children. Renew your love for your work. Renew your love for everybody whom you meet. Because that is the only way for you to find contentment and fulfillment and satisfaction and the certain knowing that love is truly all there is. And so your assignment is to make that choice every day. Every day as you awaken, say, I choose love today. Can we say that? I choose love today. There is a lovely story that Butterworth tells of a woman whose stock statement was, I agree with God only. Can we say that? I agree with God only. So when she had a negative thought, she would say, thank you for sharing, but I agree with God only. Let us say that. I agree with God only. In a half voice, I agree with God only. In a whisper, I agree with God only. And in your heart, friends, I want you to take a deep breath with me right now, and as you exhale, I want you to audibly say the universal sound, ah. So take a deep breath in. Ah. Again. Ah. And a third deep, deep breath. Ah. That is the celestial music. The music that when you are still, you can hear all of creation breathing. It is the Atman. It is God. It is the face of God in you, as you, for you. It is unquenchable. It is beautiful. It is healing. It will hold you close to its everlasting heart. One deep, deep breath with me. My friends, may you find enthroned in the high citadel of the secret place of God in your own heart that beneficence which embraces the entire world with the love that you are. I am truly in love with this teaching, and I am in love with each one of you. Namaste.